Welcome to r/maliciouscompliance, where we share stories of people conforming to the letter, but not the spirit of a request. And today we have three great stories, so subscribe, hit the like button, and let's begin. The first story, senior guy decides to be a jerk and wants to bully new employee. The second story, the boss made us watch videos during work hours. The third story, I pushed someone's SH in after they got their councilman relative to bully us on site. Today's first story is, take notes throughout the entire investigation and send them in for review? Okay. So a little bit of background for me. I'm a fraud investigator at a company who specializes in small businesses and contracting with larger companies in the Northern South Carolina / Southern North Carolina area. I'm a trained forensic accountant. However, mostly I investigate arson and or property damage. Usually the people we're investigating aren't the type for embezzlement or laundering, so my job generally consists of going with another investigator to a burned down house or business and nodding and agreeing with everything they say, as I'm not trained for arson. That being said, I spend most of my time doing paperwork in the office, as we're in a pretty small area. Though with Hurricane Florence finally wrapping up, I'm sure my workload is going to increase tenfold in the days to come. So one of our main things to make sure that we don't lie or cheat during investigations is that as soon as we open an investigation, we're required to take copious notes and even sometimes record conversations. This is all with a grain of salt, as we're not going to record a woman crying incoherently. However, we just got a new investigator who was only brought in because he was a friend of one of the current partners who set up the group. We'll call him Dean. Only problem was, the other partners who headed the group were not completely convinced that he was the investigator the other partner said he was. So he was under a watchful eye. He was a good guy and a heck of an accountant, so I liked him, but he also looked up to us for help. Here's where the big bad of the story comes in. We'll call him Mac. Mac had been with the firm for almost 15 years at this point and saw himself as a bit of a bad A. He would never follow rules, harass our female coworkers, and oftentimes come into work drunk. Him and I never worked together, but everyone called him the private eye because that's what he saw himself as. At some point in the summer, Dean, Mac, and I were paired up to investigate a report of embezzlement at a rather large chain in the area. Dean and I drove together, and Mac drove alone. We get to the chain, and we see Mac has already gotten there, and immediately starts yelling at Dean for not taking notes already, as the investigation has started. Dean shies away, and Mac gives me a dirty look, but he also knows that I can't be bullied, so he leaves me be. Mac explains to Dean that everything must be recorded no matter what. Me, feeling bad for Dean, tells him that I'll take all the notes, while Dean can record all the interviews, so on so forth. We get there and talk to the manager, who is the one who noticed the problem in the first place, and I ask to take a look at the books, to see if I can find any discrepancies, so on so forth. Dean already has his microphone on, and I'm taking notes, when Mac tells me to F off, see, that's my job. I know better than to argue, so I just nod. Dean goes with Mac while I interview the manager, and then talk to a couple of the other workers to take up time. Mac and Dean come back from getting the accounting books, and Dean looks like he's about to break down. We wrap up and leave, and Dean and I get back in the car, where he explains he was verbally abused by Mac the entire time. We get back to the partnership, and I ask if Dean had his recorder on the entire time. He said yes. This is where the malicious compliance comes in. The next day, I decide to go over the books again with Mac before continuing the investigation. I invite Dean in to see how we do things, so on so forth, and ask if I should keep on taking notes. Mac says, and I quote, yes, everything, so that we can give it all to the partners for review. So I take notes on everything. Everything. Every word spoke, every hand movement, every comment Mac made to us or anyone else. Every number. Every page turn, so on so forth. When we went back to the business, I did the same. By the end of the week, I had a small novel worth of notes, and Dean had enough recordings of voices that he could voice act 7 seasons of a show. All of this included lewd comments, racial slurs, drinking on the job, bragging about stealing cigarettes when he was 13, berating his wife on the phone, telling Dean to suck his D, telling me to F a duck, and so on so forth. From Mac. We pass the case on to our lawyers, and as a result have to turn in our notes to the partners. Imagine the surprise on their face when I come in with 76 pages front and back of notes, and Dean walks in with a USB stick full of 5 days worth of Mac being a D, and everyone else being generally pleasant. The conversation went pretty much as follows. P equals partners. M equals me. P, I see you've been taking notes. Me, yes I have. Mac being the senior member of the group told us to take notes on everything. P, well yes, that is our policy. I've never seen this type of output, though. Me, well, that USB stick has 5 days worth of conversation, and the papers have the same. P, well, could you give us the minimum we need? Me, I think you should go through it all. If not, at least read the first couple of pages, and listen to a little bit of it. The most important stuff has stars at the top of the page. P, alright, thank you. I left the office and took the weekend off. Come Monday morning, I was called into the business office, where the partners were. I was sat down and basically told that while they appreciate my commitment to my job and trying to guide Dean in the right direction, the amount of information we had compiled was unnecessary, but eye-opening in how employees were working with one another. They thanked me for the good work, but lightly warned me that another note compilation would have more backlash, only because this one was for good reason. As I walked out, I saw Mac on his way towards the business office. I excused myself to get some coffee and prepare for the day, and didn't see Mac until an hour later, angrily sitting at his desk. The next day, an email had gone out that employees are to work together in a friendly environment, as well as an empty desk and a senior investigator position opening. Wherever you are, Mac, I hope you found that private eye job you were looking for. The next story is mandatory training videos, you say? I do tech support for a medium-sized retailer. About a year and a half ago, we got a new boss. Old boss was an incompetent a-hole, so this was a good change. At first, new boss seemed like a breath of fresh air. Then, as many new bosses will, he started changing things. There was a lot about the department that needed to be changed. Old boss's mismanagement had left us undertrained, understaffed, and incredibly disorganized. But new boss's changes didn't stop at the necessary. He started feeling the need to replace things that did work, just because it wasn't what he'd had or used at his previous job. I'm sure you all know the type. One of the changes new boss made was to sign us all up for a training website where you watch videos and take practice exams. Now, this site costs a moderate amount of money to sign up for, so he added a requirement of 5 hours of training videos a month, which we do on the clock. All of us were fine with this. It gave people a break, and many of the video training tracks are certification training. Then one coworker quit, and it took forever to replace him. Then another coworker quit, and it took forever to replace him. Suddenly, our workloads had shifted. We'd lost two people who knew the systems inside and out and gotten two noobs. On top of that, one of the two had been a sysadmin, who we discovered had been screwing SH up for months, and we only discovered the damage after he left. This, on top of all the unnecessary changes new boss was making, left us very short on time. We had to prioritize help desk tickets and users, of course, and right below that was all the projects new boss had heaped on us. Training videos dropped to the absolute rock bottom of our priority list, and for several months were completely overlooked, by us and boss. Then last month, boss realized that we weren't watching our videos. He sent out an angry email, reminding us that we need to watch videos, and picked our 4 to 5 training courses for each of us to watch and take practice exams on. He decreed that these were mandatory and needed to be a high priority. So we immediately, like good little workers, dropped everything else to watch training videos. Supervisor, our network supervisor, who's technically between us and boss, walked out of his office to find no tickets being worked on and 11 techs watching movies. He stormed over and demanded to know what we were doing. We pointed at boss's email. He told us to get back to work and went and raised heck with boss. We thought that was the end of it. Then a week later, another angry email, this time with another mandatory training video for all of us on communications. He stressed in 24-point red font that this video series was mandatory with a capital M and a priority with a capital P. I added up all the little courses that he'd assigned me. This didn't come out to a few hours of training. Oh no. The courses he'd assigned me to take came out to over 250 hours of videos. So I sent out an email, CC'd to the whole department. Hey, boss, that's a lot of training videos. There's no way we can watch them at work and still get our tickets done. Can we clock in and watch them after hours? The response, yes, it just can't interfere with other work. I checked with supervisor. HR has a blanket approval on all IT overtime, and I wanted to make sure that email said what it did. Supervisor and I were pretty sure he hadn't quite gotten the connection, but we agreed that it's what it said. All of us had put in at least 20 hours of overtime watching training videos each, for the last few weeks at time and a half. A few of the guys actually did the full 40. Payroll blew a gasket. Finance blew a gasket. Boss hasn't rescinded the order, however, or told us so we can only watch so many hours a week. So every day I clock out of work, drive home, clock back into work and watch training videos and get paid to wash dishes, cook dinner, fold laundry, crochet. The last story is, it hit the fan. To preface this, I work as a wastewater technician. My job involves taking a truck with a 600-gallon water tank and a diesel-powered compressor and blowing clogs out of sewer lines. Your toilet's back up? I'm the guy the city sends out with some big mad scientist gloves and rubber boots. I love my job, not because of the subject matter, but because of the laid-back way the job operates. And the pay and benefits don't suck either. So a few weeks back, me and my coworker get a call out to this house. I look up the address, find the lateral sewer line from the house to the main on the map, and then look at the call history. This one's a problem child, and the notes even make mention of the resident, at this address being nasty, and deliberately failing to follow instructions on sewer maintenance. The fact that someone actually had to give them instructions on how to not flush hand towels down the toilet really speaks volumes here. Actual cotton hand towels, not just wet wipes. Well, we get out there, and there's a city councilman waiting for us. Turns out that the resident is their relative somehow. I didn't dig too far, and only found that out afterwards. Whatever, we do our job and check the city cleanout, and there's no flowing or standing water there. This is where our job should have ended. The city's responsibility only extends to from the sewer main to that cleanout. No further. Well, the councilman starts telling us to run our line further up. I explain that we have to have the resident sign a waiver, holding the city harmless for damages if we do that, and I have to get authorization from the wastewater department manager. The usual hoops, you know? He gets on the phone with my boss and starts rattling his cage about this. So my boss calls me on my phone, says, "Look, I know and you know that this is a bad idea, but do what he says, or he's gonna make our lives hell." I agree. The resident signs the waiver after we inform her of what could happen, and we start searching for the resident cleanout to push our line through and down to the sewer, so it'll clear the entire lateral line. Well, we can't find it. It's probably under the porch that was added sometime in the last 3 years, and we can't get to it. Councilman goes ballistic over this, of course, because how dare we peons impede his ability to impress his own family. I call my boss back and inform him of this, and he says, "That lateral runs into a manhole, right? Just go through the manhole and up towards the house." The reason that I really, really didn't want to do this is that the compressor on that truck pushes out water at something near 4,000 PSI, depending on which head we have on the hose. But the big man hath spoken. I log my token objection while fitting the lowest pressure head I have, because to heck with this, and hang up. Me and my coworker open the manhole, find the end of the lateral, and run the hose up to where we think the clog is. And fire! Suddenly all kinds of stuff comes flowing out of the line. We cleared the clog. Yay us! We tell the resident to go flush her toilet so we can make sure it's flowing properly. She goes back in and then comes storming out, screaming about suing the city, we've destroyed her home, etc. I don't need to listen because I already know what happened and she'd been warned. The pressure blew back up the 4-inch wide lateral, right up to her toilet and out of it, along with everything in its way. It hit the ceiling, it hit the window, it hit the walls. Councilman blows the gasket and I point out that she signed a waiver, and that my boss has every call to or from his office recorded as a matter of official communication, so we have him ordering us to do this, and had informed both of them of the risks prior. We then left and headed back to the yard, and left that guy screaming into a phone. My boss didn't stop laughing for at least 10 minutes after we got back, and started making photocopies of the waiver form we'd had the resident sign. I heard there was some kerfluffle about the whole incident at the next big meeting, and those photocopies were distributed, along with the recording of the councilman's call. I never heard of it going further than that. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you liked it, don't forget to subscribe and turn on notifications.